Welcome to ABCs of Anaesthesia. My name is Lahiru, and for this episode of Anaesthesia Worst Case Scenarios, we're going to go through the anterior mediastinal mass as it relates to the anaesthetist. And as always, I'll make this for YouTube, but I'll also make it available on our ABCs of Anaesthesia podcast channel as well, depending on which medium you want to view it in. Now, the anterior mediastinal mass, this is obviously a really high-risk situation, high-risk lesion, but also something that we're not going to see a lot of in our careers, most of our anaesthesia careers. And so a lot of this really, really important information I've gained not from my own experience, but from the experience of other colleagues of mine, as well as this really fantastic article from 2007 called Management of the Patient with a Large Anterior Mediastinal Mass, Recurring Myths by Sling and Carsley. Now, you know, taking the experience of those experts in the field, I thought it's just really worthwhile to try and translate that into this kind of viva format. We'll go through some questions, go through a lot of exam technique as well for this ANZCA exam. So let's get started. Now, this won't obviously be seen on the podcast, but what I've brought up here is a chest x-ray for you to describe. So describe this chest x-ray. Now, what I'll try to do is I'll describe it and describe my strategy as best as I can. So this chest x-ray looks pretty normal. Now, in the face of a normal chest x-ray or normal investigation or something where I'm unsure what's going on, I just try a very systematic approach. And the systematic approach for any investigation is, first of all, identifying the name, the date and time, and the actual investigation itself. So this will be this person, this date, this time, and this looks like a PA chest x-ray. Now, the format for chest x-ray is often A, B, C, D, so looking at the airways, looking at the bony structures, C for looking at the cardiovascular structures, and then D for the diaphragm. So just going through this, it looks like the trachea is normal, there's no deviation, the lung fields look normal as well. Looking at the bony landmarks, the ribs look normal as well. Really, everything looks normal. The cardiovascular contours, the size looks normal as well, and the diaphragmatic borders look normal. So the costovertebral angles look normal. So essentially, there's a normal chest x-ray. And in this particular viva, I'm pretty much saying that it is normal. I give another chest x-ray. Again, this is normal because I'm trying to prove a point that people really need to have a system when they go through this. Now, this one, it's actually not a chest x-ray, but it's a CT scan with the sample of what it would look like as a chest x-ray. And it shows an obvious deformity here. So for this, in this particular circumstance, it would almost seem to be unusual for you to go through everything systematically when there's such an obvious problem with this chest x-ray. So for the podcast listeners, this shows, you know, marked deviation of the trachea as well as narrowing of the trachea. So when there's such a marked lesion, I go straight to the point. I say, look, there's an obvious deformity. It looks like there's a structure that's deviating the trachea to the right side and causing narrowing of the trachea itself. This could be a mediastinal mass. So I say, state facts first, and maybe if I want to have a go, I say what it could be. Now, at that point, the examiner might want to move on because you've got, you know, you hit the nail straight on the head. Other times, it might be that you aren't giving enough information, and then I go back to my structure in more detail. So I say, this is what's most grossly abnormal, but in more detail, this is this patient, this time, this date, this is a chest x-ray or whatever scan it is. And starting from the top, airway looks like this, there is that marked deformity, bones, B for bones, C for cardiovascular structures, and D for diaphragm. Okay, now the viva goes on to give a situation. You're called to assist in CT. You have a 35-year-old female, no past history, no medications, and no known drug allergies. And apparently this patient has an undiagnosed anterior mediastinal mass for a CT scan. The patient cannot lie flat, and they would like you to give the patient a bit of quick sedation. What do you do? Now, in this circumstance, there's obviously a lot that you need to go into. And the point of this is that someone with positional symptoms, because they cannot lie flat in this example, it'd be very, very dangerous for you to proceed down sedation or general anesthesia pathway. So what do you do? I'd say, look, I need more information. I'd do a full assessment, but essentially I wouldn't be happy to give sedation or GA. So this would be a critical error in this circumstance to go ahead and just give a bit of quick sedation, because that can have dramatically bad consequences for the patient. So I might also offer that the fact that the scan can be done in a different way. So for example, you don't need to do this with sedation if the patient's positional symptoms, because first of all, the scan can be done in many different positions, semi-recumbent, lateral, even prone, and also can be done very quickly. So a scan can be done very effectively in 20 seconds. without affecting scan quality. So it's very important that you know this information because you don't want to rush into doing sedation or general anesthetic for a patient with anterior mediastinal mass and severe or any positional symptoms. So that's really the point of this question. I want to see that you don't rush into that. So what are the causes of mediastinal mass? And we talk about the four T's: a terrible lymphoma, thymoma, germ cell tumor or teratoma, and thyroid tumor, but there's also others. Another good way of really categorizing this would be to think of the structures in the mediastinum. So what is the treatment? Now in this question, there's no reason for you to really know all the detail of treatments for, you know, these kind of pathologies. That's not really your job as an anaesthetist, but there's something really important about this. So what I'd say for this question is really where I try to get the candidate to think about the fact that you have surgical and medical treatments. So you wouldn't want to rush into surgery for something that's so dire and so risky when there could be medical treatment. So really the point of this is that fact that lymphoma is non-surgical. You only really have surgery for complications of lymphoma, such as pericardial effusion, tamponade, or pleural effusions, but really lymphoma is for medical management. But then there's other tumors like mesenchymal tumors, ectopic endocrine tumors, as well as thyroid tumors and thymomas that might need surgical management. So let's say they still have no diagnosis after doing the CT scan. You go ahead with the CT scan, you alter the position, and you still don't have a diagnosis, and the surgeon wishes to go to theater for sternotomy. What do you want to know about the patient's workup? Now, this is probably a bit of an artificial situation, but I'm trying to prove a point here with this particular question. The fact that you don't have a diagnosis is a really big deal, and you really need to get that diagnosis. So I'd want to know everything about the patient's workup. Have they had everything possible to make sure that a diagnosis has been attempted? For example, not only have they had the full blood panel, you know, the history examination, but also investigations and biopsies that are, you know, like CT guided biopsies, mediastinoscopy, anything else for a tissue sample to get a diagnosis. Just to repeat, once you have a diagnosis, you can know whether this is for medical management or for surgical management. That's really vital. In real life, the other specialists around you, the surgeon, the oncologist, the physician, they will know so much more about this condition than the anaesthetist, than most anaesthetists would. And so this is unlikely to happen in real life, that you'd go straight to theater for sternotomy without doing all the proper investigations. But again, this is just to prove a point that diagnosis is really important, and also the diagnosis can be done without going to theater for a sternotomy. So the next question really is, you know, what could you do to get a diagnosis? And there's many things you could do. So awake CT guided needle biopsy, awake anterior mediastinoscopy, or diagnostic thoracocentesis. So what we're doing here is we can use CT guided techniques with local and minimal sedation, awake anterior mediastinoscopy with just local anesthesia, as well as taking samples from peripheral sites. For example, imagine you do have a lymphoma. Like a lymphoblastic lymphoma has a high incidence of pleural effusions, and so you could sample that pleural fluid and maybe get a diagnosis, therefore not going to theater. Now we're ready for medical management. Or maybe there's a peripheral lymph node that you could biopsy and again get a diagnosis and not have to go to surgery just for a diagnosis or for no reason at all, especially if it's a high risk anesthetic. So diagnosis does not require a GA. So summary, diagnosis can be made in almost all cases without a general anesthetic. Rushing to do a general anesthetic can be a critical error. Now moving on with this exam question, the patient presents to the pre-admission clinic for workup prior to sternotomy. What do you want to know on assessment would be the question. So again, I talk about the point of difference or the critical issues about this patient. So there's a whole bunch of routine anesthetic assessments that you could go through, but what I try to do is try to get to the point straight away. In addition to my routine anesthetic assessment, I'm really concerned about specific things. I'm worried about, you know, trachea bronchial compression or the respiratory structures, and then all the cardiovascular structures. So superior vena cava compression, atrial compression, and pulmonary vessel compression. So really any of the low pressure structures. I'm also concerned because it's cancer. I'm now using my framework of the 5 M's. So I'm thinking of, you know, the mass effect, which I've already talked about, respiratory and cardiovascular structure compression, any metastases or mets, any medication the patient's on, any metabolic consequences of this tumor, and also the mental state of the patient. And this is all in addition to my routine assessment. So if the examiner wasn't happy with that, I could always say in more detail, I'd go through, you know, past history of any anesthesia, PONV history, family history of any problems, etc., etc. So on history and examination, this is again where I think it's really good to have a structure. I like to divide this into tracheal bronchial symptoms, cardiovascular symptoms, and then the positional nature of any of these symptoms and the rapidity of progression. The tracheal bronchial symptoms would include stridor, cough, hoarseness of voice, and dyspnea. And the cardiovascular symptoms could be those of superior vena cava obstruction, like Pemberton sign, flushing, venous engorgement, edema in the upper limbs, or syncope, orthopnea, decreased exercise tolerance, anything like that. And again, to reinforce, I really want to know, if there's any particular positions that are better for the patient, if it has any positional symptoms, and the degree of that, as well as knowing the rapidity of progression, because this might make us want to go a bit quicker with rebooking the surgery. So let's say in this example, the patient has tracheal compression. What exactly do you want to know? And when I think about this, I really want to know all the mechanics of how I'm going to ventilate this patient with an endotracheal tube. So really, I want to know how narrow this is. What size tube can I pass through the lesion? So aperture size, the length of the problem, the length of the constriction, and also is there any distance below the lesion? So any, how far from the constriction in the trachea down to the carina. It will be a really big problem if there's any loss of cross-sectional area that's greater than 50%. That's a really bad sign, as well as if there's any compression at the carinal level or bronchial compression. So again, really big problem. But in summary, I'm trying to think of where I can pass this tube. The aperture size, the constriction amount, how long that constriction is, and if there's any distance below the constriction. Now, in the article, they talk about, beware the pediatric case. So anesthetic deaths have mainly been reported in children, and children with trachea bronchial compression of greater than 50% cannot be safely given a GA. So safe awake techniques are really not possible. So what's your choice of anesthetic? Now, this is obviously a really complicated area, and it'll take planning a multidisciplinary approach, and really you'd want to have a lot of information before you go ahead. Now, one of my consultants at my training hospital gave me what I thought was a really practical way of handling this situation. So basically three groups of patients. The first group is probably the safest group. So no symptoms and no cardiovascular or airway obstruction on imaging. The second group, minimal symptoms, but imaging does show compression of the cardiovascular or airway structures, and they're not, that bad. They're not that severe. Finally, the worst group is severe positional symptoms due to airway or cardiovascular system compression. So three groups. The first two can be safe, but the final group is very, very dangerous. So for the first and second group, what I'd say is you really want to have a very cautious approach. So all your usual preparation, but increase your monitoring. You have an ART line, maybe a CVC, maybe even a cardiac output monitor. Now, if there's any flow issues from, venous congestion or constriction of the superior vena cava, you would want to have your intravenous line in the lower limb. I also make mention that I want the surgeons in the room prepped and draped for sternotomy or rigid bronchoscopy as well. Now, the technique, most of the time we talk about the spontaneous ventilation technique. So this is an inhalational induction, and then I have various plans depending on what is going on. So if there's tracheal obstruction, maybe I could do an awake fiber optic, positioning the tube past the obstruction. The spont venting induction could be with sevoflurane or whatever intravenous mixture that you're familiar with. And then think about this. Once you've got the patient spont venting and everything is tolerated, you can gradually give positive pressure to take over ventilation. And at that point, if the positive pressure causes a drop in preload and drop in blood pressure, you can always recover from that. So you can check if it's tolerated, go slowly, and only then give muscle relaxant, again, cautiously, knowing that you may have to do your emergency techniques at any time. So if life-threatening airway or vascular compression occurs, then this gets a bit trickier. So overall, each of these has all the problems of, if there's threatened airway or severe cardiovascular compromise, you've got all your normal causes of cardiovascular compromise and airway problems in an anesthetic, but also all the problems that could occur from the mass effect. So you really have to be solving both problems at once. So as a really basic plan, firstly, you may need to awake the patient rapidly to explore other options. You've already discovered the patient's least symptomatic position, so having a team ready to reposition, whether it's lateral or somehow prone or semi-prone, whatever it is, you need to be able to do that very quickly. So having the team ready to do that on induction would be necessary. If there's lethal airway compression, rigid bronchoscopy could be useful. and for lethal cardiovascular compression, sternotomy, and surgical elevation of the mass off the great vessels or whatever cardiovascular structures are causing the problem. So let's talk about some details. When is rigid bronchoscopy unlikely to be helpful? So, you know, we think of rigid bronch as the savior of this situation of airway compromise, but really it can be difficult in certain situations. Imagine C-spine immobility, or imagine difficult upper airway anatomy. So always plan for airway loss and have that discussion with the surgeon. Maybe the surgeon is not familiar or not as expert at this technique, and you really need to clarify all these details when you talk about the surgical issues. So let's say we put a crisis into this exam. You perform a spont vent induction with sevoflurane. So let's imagine this patient is a 50-year-old, large thyroid malignancy, no past history, no allergies, no positional symptoms, but the malignancy is large and extends retrosternally. There's minimal narrowing of the trachea. And the patient then becomes hypertensive with the blood pressure trending down to 70 millimeters mercury. So again, this is such a high-risk situation. I'd go through my framework. So first of all, telling everyone that this is potentially has a check my reading. If it's an artline, make sure the transducer is in the right spot. I'd immediately call for help, and help would almost always be standing by because it's such a high-risk induction. And then I scan the patient, the surgeon, the monitors. I really want to get an idea of what's going on through the other causes as well. So I think about what are the causes of hypertension, and I treat the normal causes. So I'd give a bolus of fluid as well as giving metaraminol and or ephedrine, depending on what my monitors are saying. But then I'll be really concerned about the tamponade effect of the mediastinal mass, so then I'll prepare another team to help solve that problem. So how would I treat this? I would use normal measures, as I mentioned. I'd use volume inotropes and vasopressor. Plus, I'd mobilize staff to maneuver the patient, position them into the rescue position, their least symptomatic position, which is probably left lateral, right lateral to start with, and then ensure that the surgeons are ready to do a sternotomy at that point as well, if that failed. So again, how do you decide the rescue positions, and what are these rescue positions? So they're always determined preoperatively. Least symptomatic position is probably where you want the patient to be if things go bad. And also think about the anatomical relationship of the lesion and the structures. The rescue positions can be anything really, but upright, seated, lateral, or prone. So there's a question about, is standby cardiopulmonary bypass useful? And when you think about the fact that it takes 5 to 10 minutes at best to cannulate and establish circulation and oxygenation, even with everything ready to go, so this can be quite a long time. So really, in the situation that the patient is very symptomatic with, you know, severe lesions on imaging, really, it can be such a hazardous thing to go ahead with a general anesthetic. So cardiopulmonary bypass or ECMO is to be done prior to induction, according to this article. So then the next question, why are children more at risk from anesthesia for mediastinal mass? So really, children are overrepresented in the adverse outcomes, and it could be due to a number of factors, but maybe due to the more compressible nature of airway and surrounding structures, a small decrease in the lumen, and a large increase in the airway's resistance because the airway is already smaller. There could also be difficulties of getting a clear history and symptomatology from a child. So I just want to summarize three groups of patients. You've got your first group, no symptoms and no CVS or airway obstruction or imaging, and then the second group, minimal symptoms, but imaging shows some compression that's not too severe. In those two groups, you can go ahead with the general anesthetic with a very cautious approach. Again, obviously consult your treating team and experts in this field who've done this before embarking on this. But the mediastinal mass with severe positional symptoms due to airway or cardiovascular compromise, awake ECMO, cardiopulmonary bypass prior, is something you have to consider and is likely the safest technique for the patient. So in summary, we've just gone through the most important elements on history, which are quite logical. What are the problems with tracheobronchial obstruction or airway obstruction and pressure on vascular structures? You need a diagnosis, which can be done with local anesthetic only. And don't rush ahead with general anesthesia or deep sedation. You need a diagnosis, and that way you can stratify what you need to do. Severe positional symptoms in patients can be an absolute disaster. We went through a bit of a basic approach, three groups of patients, and the most severe patients, severe symptoms, severe obstruction on imaging, need to be considered for cardiopulmonary bypass or ECMO, and the other groups of patients, the first and second group, a careful general anesthesia plan with all the fail-safe mechanisms and everything in place. Thanks so much for watching ABCs of Anesthesia and the Anesthesia Worst Case Scenarios, and for this installment of Anterior Mediastinal Masses. So as always, if you enjoyed this, please like and subscribe, and thanks very much for watching.